You asked the hardest question of all. When I was writing my book, I put the same question to people, including this someone who was preparing the national budget under the president many years ago, and he said, "I'd be damned if I know." So it's a very difficult question. There are easy answers, like it's a measure of value, or it's a promise. And that's a little bit more interesting as an answer, because what it represents is a question. What does it represent? What's behind it? It's a means of exchange. It's a means of people living together and dealing and exchanging with each other material things, or and sometimes emotional things, and all kinds of human elements being exchanged with money nowadays. But it originally, I believe, was invented as a piece of social technology, a very great invention, to help people realize their independence or interdependence, dependence upon each other, and share common aims and common goods. So it served, I think, if not a spiritual, at least a very deeply human function, and from the earliest times. So it's a token of exchange. It's a convenient way of value of exchanging goods. Instead of carrying a cow, you carry a coin, you know, all that sort of thing. But it's such a difficult question. It has so many different aspects to money. It's an emotional thing just as much as it is a material thing. And we'll get into the subject of what is the meaning of money in a deeply human life. So I have no one answer to the question, but when you really ponder what is money very deeply, you get into such interesting questions that the question itself becomes more interesting than any answer you might get, which is true of all the great questions of life. Really, as a philosopher, I believe that a deepening of a question is much better than a quick answer. Because when you really deepen a serious question, you open up a part of yourself that is more valuable than anything else. But it's, first of all, what I've tried in all my books, because I was deeply interested in spiritual thought, philosophical thought, philosophical spiritual thought, the teachings of the great religious traditions of the world. And it's a long story there, but I came to see, and I'm fairly sure of this, that all the great spiritual traditions in history point to the same truths, the same realities, and the same values. And so I became very interested in that sort of fundamental system of thought that's behind all the great traditions, what some people have called the primordial tradition. But when I started to write books, I discovered that really what I want to explore is the question of whether these great teachings behind all the spiritual traditions can throw light, illuminate the concrete everyday gut level problems and questions of our own everyday life in this culture, in this world, in our day-to-day lives. So I've been looking for a bridge between this vast, wonderful, inspiring, transcendent system of teaching, of ideas, and the questions of our everyday life. And so each one of my books had that kind of a question. And having written about psychology and medicine and science and education of a kind of sort, I realized that the money question was really one of the most troubling, gnawing questions, aching questions of our time, of our life in this culture, because money in this culture has entered into more aspects of human life. Our lives have become more monetized and commodified than I believe any other culture ever. Money is in everything, enters into everything. Everything has become market-driven in some way or other, or defined almost everything. Things that used to be part of just human exchange without the money entering good now cost something, and what is billed for it. And you have to face the money question almost everywhere you go, wherever you are, with your children, with your life, with your profession, with your living and dying. So what does it mean? Why is it so important? What is its real importance? So this became a question. I had never seen it treated in any book or study. What is the meaning of money in our lives? Now, there are books that, treatises that do speak about it a little bit, and sometimes very deeply, but they're not the ones that anybody really knows very well, very much. That was in the late 1980s, when we were such a sick, big materialist culture. That was our main problem, in a way, really. So I said, how can I? That would be a really interesting question. What is the relation of money to a human being in a human life that is searching for meaning, for its inner development, let's say? What place should money have? And it took me 2 years to even write the first sentence of that book, because I couldn't start thinking about it. I said, this is really a great question, but there's been no other studies. Everybody writes about money, to how to make it, how to keep it, where to distribute it, how to spend it, et cetera, et cetera. But nobody would place money like that in any realistic way. Yes, there were sentimental things, money's not important, but all that was not real where it is. Then, so there was a movie, not a very good movie, that I saw, a friend of mine helped make, called Waterhole Number 3. It disappeared from the universe, justly so. But it had James Coburn in it, and he was a good guy, an adventurer, etc. Anyway, he's running away at the end of the movie with some gold, that gold bullion. He's being pursued by all the other people who think it's theirs, the Indians and the army, and various individuals with shotguns and bows and arrows, and he's racing toward the border to get from Mexico into the United States. This is the last frames of the movie. As he crosses over the border, he turns around and looks at the camera, and he says, the problem is with money that we take it too seriously. And then he turns away, and then he turns back to the camera and says, no, the problem with money is that we're not serious enough about it. And that was a very interesting thing to say. And that's what I found were at the theme of my book, was how to be serious about money. Be serious about money, give it the seriousness it demands and it deserves, without being swallowed by it. And that's really part of what we need to understand. So I came to the conclusion, after thinking and writing about it, because sometimes one writes a book having a question without knowing the answer, and uses the writing, as one does in teaching, to try to think about the question. And I discovered, I've made what I considered a great discovery about what the meaning of money. And that's based on the spiritual idea that's in many of the great traditions, that we human beings have two natures, two sides. We are spiritual, there's a spiritual divine element in us, and there's a material body and material needs and worldly activities that are absolutely essential as a part of our life, raising a family, creating things, doing good deeds, etc., etc. Many other things. That is our life in the world. We're born into that world. We must act in that world. But we have this other side, which comes from another dimension, you might say, which is which we are born also to open up in ourselves. If we're not born with that, we are born with it really there, but we very quickly get closed off from it and live our life without contacting it. And if we don't contact that part of ourselves, that spiritual inner, higher consciousness, you might say, higher energy, then our life becomes simply lost in outward things. And there are, what are in themselves are not evil, but they're only one half, or a little less than half in a way, but say one half of our nature. But the other nature, if that isn't developed, life is meaningless. So our aim is to develop and to live fully and give each side of ourselves the attention it deserves so that it can be balanced and I can live a life where I have this inner world which is then manifested in action. Money represents in the contemporary world, the modern world, the, if not a, but if not maybe even the principal means of organizing one half of our life, the material outward part. That's very important. For better or worse, money helps us to organize there how we live nowadays, this outward part. But it doesn't give us anything of the inner world. With money, you can't buy the inner world. But you can study yourself very well. How you act with money is a big key to how you, all the hypocrisies and all the problems we have. That's a big key to our values in the world. And when you have knowledge of yourself, that is sacred. Knowledge about ourselves is sacred, even though what we know about the money is not itself particularly sacred. So I felt that, in that sense, money is one of the great keys to us, to self-knowledge in our contemporary world. If you want to know yourself, as one great teacher once said, observe how you are or with money, sex, and time. So I wrote three books dealing with money, not sex exactly, but love and time. But money was the first one. They're those three things. So that's the answer, long answer to a short question. I'm not a historian, but it's so difficult to sweeping generalizations and to have the myths we have about the Middle Ages and the myths we have about the modern world. But so how to say it? The medieval world that I'm speaking about had a, with many things were horrible about it, but it had a religious, in a good sense of the term, a religious underpinning. The Christian Church, the Catholic Church, the Christianity was still sort of somewhere behind things. It was, yes, it had corruption, it had all kinds of things, dogmatic, and but there was a living Christianity in the Middle Ages, and that helped to determine values, even if they weren't always lived up to, or often lived up to, because the Middle Ages was very violent in many, many ways. The modern era, and then you had this transitional time, where something more of the world, the horizontal dimension of human life became, the Renaissance, if you like, or the humanism, that the human dimension, and there was a kind of different take developing about God and religion. The human dimension began to be explored. It wasn't anti-religious exactly, but it was more the human side, the worldly side, the side of where scientific discovery, which had existed, of course, throughout history and in the Middle Ages, had tremendous science, but the scientific revolution, the philosophical enlightenment, starting with great philosophers like Descartes and Hume and finally Immanuel Kant, and the whole enlightenment humanistic revolution, which put religion in a different place and sometimes questioned it and sometimes denied it altogether and rejected it. And as science developed and humanity began to discover its power over nature, in a way that never could have been dreamt of before, perhaps because it wasn't even wanted before. It wasn't so important, that kind of power. And so that, even though the fathers, the originators of the scientific revolution, people like Newton and Galileo and Kepler and other great scientists, were spiritual people. They weren't materialistic in any way or reductive particularly. Science was a noble enterprise with Newton and others. It was to try to discover how God operated in the world. Newton was a very spiritually inclined human being. He was thinking, this is how God does these things. But then there came a time when something turned, when some people began to think, well, if that's, now we know, beginning to know how God does things, that's how I'm going to act when I become God. And people began to feel their own power. Science gave them power. And that was the beginning of something that was certainly anti-religious, non-religious, that began to be permanent current in the modern world until we got war, religious war became more obvious. There's so much to say in this subject, but it became to a point where religion looked like something which science was opposed to, and science looked like something that threatened religion. It doesn't have to be that way, but that's the way it became. So, to put it in a word, materialism, even of a very refined sort, became more and more dominant, and the church and religious doctrine and dogma began to occupy only a part of the human adventure, and more material realities became important, and the scientific explanation became defined by how it can reduce all questions, all unknowns, to their material dimension, and explain things by reducing it to physics and chemistry and non-purposeful, non-conscious, non-soulful realities. So I haven't said it very well, but it's in that dimension that money became somehow, through technology development and through making the world function more as a better machine, money became part of oiling the machine, that things could be exchanged, material values could be worked on, money could be if you had a world that was operating on, say, a certain kind of great discovery of how to synchronize time throughout the world, how you could make time go very, very predictably through quantification, through external measurements, say the clock, which is a great invention of the modern world, and that's the modern timepiece. Then business became a huge force in the life of humanity, where in the Middle Ages there was business, but not this kind of world business started to take place. Now, I'm just going through sweeping generalizations here, but it's in that direction that one aspect of this must be understood. There are plenty others which I can't think of right now, but we're in a world where somehow spiritual, inner, even aesthetic values do not seem as real as the values associated with money. And that's one of the great questions of my book. How did it happen that money seems most so real? Why is it that the word bottom line means that's what it really is? And it is, in a way, when you have money involved in a relationship or in a situation, it becomes more real. You know, I can talk to you, we can make great plans, we can like each other, we care for each other, etc. But when I ask you can you loan me $1,000 or something? Well, there's something is... Now, maybe you can and will, but there's another reality appeared. So money makes things real, for better or worse. Why it does is because our feelings and our passions associated with money and what money can buy are stronger than the feelings of our inner life. So our inner life seems not as real as our life with money. this is, again, wildly generalizing it, but my reactions to money, for many of us in our childhood, where money difficulties were so important for many people, that, you know, we were sort of brought up, by the time we were conscious, young men and women, money was critical in our thinking and our feeling. So money became so real. But in itself, it's nothing. It represents something, but in itself, what is it? As they say, it's only paper, but it represents something very real. It's a promise. And when the promise is broken, chaos, as we have seen nowadays. The promise of money, that I give you X dollars, that's worth something. And when it stops being worth it, or let's say an inflation or something like that, there's chaos in the world. So it's very important that we keep money in a stable way, dynamically stable. But no one knows how to do it. No one really understands what's going on right now. A lot of very brilliant people write about it. But the emotional element of money has not yet been taken into account by economists or anybody, really. Money is emotion. I can do a lot with money. And money is necessary. Money is good. If you use it in a good way, it can do wonderful things. I was in a conference once with about money at a university, and in those days there was still now, many young people had a kind of contempt for wealthy executives and things. Oh, you know, the head of Exxon or something, oh, bad. But the man who helped me the most understand money, the businessman I write about in my book, he said a very strong thing which I quoted in the book. He says, in order to do anything good to help mankind, you need the help of wealthy people. You need money. You really do. You can't really save the whales or the trees, or you can't help starve poverty. You can't do anything unless there's money to take care of how to do it. And there are many really thoughtful, intelligent people who do have lots of money, who would like to help and are helping. So one has to recognize that there are things that money really can buy, and very, very good. And therefore, one needs to respect money and not to be devout. So how to have money without being had by it? That's my, in a sweatshirt, motto. How to have it without being had by it. Power, tremendous power. And the people who have lots of money are as puzzled by it as those who don't. Nobody knows what's going on. I'm not talking about today, but in general. Like I said, the person who helped with the United States budget didn't really know. It wasn't just joking. It didn't really know, what is money? Where? What does it come from? What's it do? What's it for, really? What can it buy? Money can buy lots of good things. It can, not just comfort and luxury, it can buy friendship of a certain kind. It can't buy love of a certain kind, but it can buy some kind of love, and I don't mean cheap things. I mean the things that are, if I have money, I can make a gift that really expresses my feeling towards somebody. It's not nothing, but what is it? It can't buy. It can buy. One of the most interesting things I faced in the book was the realization that, you know, there are almost no problems in our life that can't be solved, at least temporarily, by a specific amount of money. Oh, no, my relation with my mother is... Now, just think for a minute. What if, suppose you had 20 times as much money as you have now, how would it help? Yeah, I can see where I could do this with her. So there are certain, almost nothing. There are things that can't be bought with money, but many more things can than we've imagined. And that's not being materialistic, because money doesn't mean just material things. No. Oh, but there's one thing money can't buy, in my opinion. and I'm putting again another bumper sticker. Money can buy everything except meaning. Meaning comes from the two natures, being in balance, your spiritual inner side and your outer life. And that money by itself can't buy that, but your relationship to money can help you develop your relation between the inner world and the outer world. Let me say then that this is how I see it. You can study yourself, which is, for me, a key to this, to spiritual development. The path that I think is of great value starts with self-knowledge. It goes knowledge of how I am in my everyday life, this part of me, and knowledge of this other higher part. And the knowledge of my everyday psychological, personal patterns and traps and failures and self-deceptions and etc. can be revealed by studying, among other things, by studying how I am with money. Because how I am, to study how I am with money is very difficult and very revealing and very humbling, because you see that you are not what you think you are with money. And so that becomes a source of self-observation, as it can be called. And just not to do anything to make it, but just to study somebody. You see somebody at a party, looks like an ordinary schmo. Everybody's talking. Somebody says, "You know who that is? He's a billionaire." Suddenly, my feelings toward this person. Oh, really? A nice-looking man. You know, you go up to him and get to know him. Maybe you think money will pour down from him to you or something. But your feelings change. If somebody is rich, it makes a difference to you. It makes a difference, and it makes a difference to them. They don't know what to do with it either. People who are wealthy very often, who have inherited it particularly, they can be wonderful people, and some of them are very unhappy. Like movie stars, if they're not brought up in a certain way with lots of money, I've known many wealthy people, they don't have any sense of why people care for them except for their money. So they become a little paranoid, a little lonely, looking for people like themselves who have lots of money. But so having lots of money is not necessarily a key to, you know, it's a joke. Yes, I could stand it. I could bear it. Give me a couple of million and I'll be able to bear it. But it's so we have to see how the emotions are related to money. And they're deeply related. And economists who try to speak of the rational economic theories, rational, I think it's all totally wrong. You have to really deeply understand human emotions in order to understand money. Ad people know that a little bit, but on a cheesy way. But it represents something deep. So self-knowledge is what I'm talking about. Money is a key to knowing yourself, and it's hard to bear. You try to, an exercise I give, and sometimes it's people class of, when I public lecture, I ask the participants to go out in the street and use a dollar, $1. Now maybe it should be $5, but give a dollar to the first person you see, not a homeless person who's begging and not someone selling, but just go up to an ordinary person in the street and say, "Would you like a dollar?" And you'll see how difficult that is to do it, but also how difficult it is to receive it. Person will say, "What are you doing? What is this? What's the catch?" And it's a very interesting exercise to see how you are with money. More interesting for many people, not everyone, is to keep a strict budget for a week, to just buy every penny to write down. For many people, that's hard. That's hell. For other people, do it automatically. But most people, and it shows you what you value, where you spend your money. What you tote it up at the end, what you spend your money is where you've given your, what you've given your values to, one way or the other. Sometimes you have to, but. So all that is part of the spiritual dimension of money, self-knowledge. Absolutely true. Absolutely true. I like to think of myself in a certain way, but when the money thing appears, I see I manifest against what I think I ought to be. You know, it's always interesting what happens when someone leaves a lot of money and they die, and how it tears most families apart. Or just sitting at the dinner at a restaurant, when a nice restaurant with a group of friends, when the check starts arriving, and to see whose hand moves just slow enough, just fast enough to be respectable, but slow enough not to be the first one to reach for it. But of course, there are generous people who reach for it. But on the other hand, it is a dance sometimes of who's going to pick up the check. That's a very trivial example, but these trivial examples show us something about money. There are laws to money, too. There was a nice book long ago by Michael Phillips called The Seven Laws of Money. Michael Phillips, I think it was. And I think there's a lot of truth in some of what used to be considered New Age, New Agey. But, you know, when you give money away in a certain way, it seems to grow back. It's very interesting about giving. there was a beggar on this downtown San Francisco. When I used to go down Union Square, he had no legs. He was just sitting on a rolling platform with a cup. A nice-looking man, obviously had a decent, intelligent face, just sitting there holding out a basket or a cup, I don't know what. And very often people would walk around him. You know how we prefer, in our culture, people are made nervous by beggars of any kind and walk around him. And so I went across the street and I must confess, I walked around him. And then a block down the street, there was a pet mobile, Save the Cats. It was for cats, dogs and cats, but I think mainly cats were at the figure. This woman was writing a big check for cats. And block down the street, there was a man without any legs. Now, maybe I'm being sentimental, but I felt, you know, couldn't she at least have done half that check to the man with the legs? So what are we afraid of? And I'm like everyone, you know, it's like my first reaction is fear. So I went back and I salved my conscience by giving the man without legs some money. But that kind of thing, to try to see that, to be present in yourself while you watch how you are to money, is like a rich harvest of self-knowledge. And people want to borrow money from you, from me, you know, then I become very often a very different person. And I have to see that, not necessarily become better, but just see it. And another thing, of course, is to really try to look at your childhood, your first experiences with money. How was it with your family, with your parents? Some people had wonderful, generous parents, and there wasn't a problem, but nevertheless, almost everybody has something from money in their childhood that determines something about how they are later. What your mother said about how you should earn something, or your father said, or whatever it is. It's very deep. Used to gather money as a kid, you know, when I was a young little child, coins were hugely important. And I remember, this is silly, I remember how a dime was such a powerful thing. Because with a nickel you could buy an ice cream cone, you could do it. But a dime was twice as powerful as a nickel, but it was twice as small. And I couldn't understand, can a dime, which is so much smaller, be so much more powerful than a nickel? So I didn't really grasp that money represented something. Then I had an uncle who would come, who I loved. And he would come and he'd give me a half a dollar. Half a dollar was like a mountain. He just gave it to me. I couldn't grasp that generosity. later on that became a standard of generosity for me, because what he gave was something so big to such a small child. So generosity is a wonderful trait. Profligacy is not. And so all those things correspond to personal traits. And if we want to know ourselves, we need to study all that. And money is a golden key to doing that in this culture. Let's talk about greed.
Let's talk about greed. Yeah. I mean, are we just inherently greedy, or is...
No. How would you define greed? Greed is wanting more than you need, or taking more than you need, or taking without any measure. Like, for example, when I asked one very successful businessman when I was writing the book, and he must have been, in those days, hugely wealthy. He must have been worth at least half a billion, I would say, which was much bigger than it is now. I said to him, and he was still involved in money. He's an interesting guy. He interviewed me. How much is enough? I asked him. His jaw dropped. He said, yeah, you know, I never thought of that question. I just make it. So people say, just don't make it. Maybe that's greed. On the other hand, in a culture like this, in economic times like we are in and we have been in for a long time in a way, how much is enough? You don't know. It could fall apart at any minute. So there has been this kind of culture of just keep making it without trying to decide how much is enough. Now, many people now, the revolution is appearing, are trying to say, this, it can't go on. There is enough. I don't need all that. That's beginning to happen in the margins of the culture. People are saying, so I don't need all that. Look at all the stuff here. We all have stuff. Are we all greedy? We have much more than we need. Is that greed? We're not greedy. In that sense, it's not like somebody twirling their mustaches and getting, but there are greedy people. There are, but what is it? So, when a bank executive who screws up royally gets paid $75 million for leaving when he leaves, and maybe complains that he should get another 20 or something, that's greed. But just to know what it is, though, is sort of percolated down to our culture much more than just with very big rich people. I had a friend of mine who's a very developed, wonderfully interesting man, and he is a carpet salesman, and I asked him, what does he do, what is he good at in his life? It's an exercise I give sometimes for writing workshops. What do you do well? And he said, he's a good carpet salesman. I said, all right, now what's the most important human characteristic in being a good rug salesman? And he thought and thought, and he said, greed. And I said, okay, write a little essay about greed. So he wrote a beautiful little piece about how he is when he sells a carpet. And it was greed, but in a way, around the edges, he was so aware of what he was doing. He was so aware that he was being greedy, that it lost a lot of its toxicity, a lot of its poison. So to be a vice, a pattern of human behavior has to be unconscious, mechanical. And when a person is consciously greedy, in a way, it takes some of the poison out of it, because when you're really conscious of what you're doing, it operates against it becoming really deadly and hurtful too much to someone. So my take on greed is it's a totally mechanical, conditioned, unconscious hunger for more, which is, a lot of us have in many different ways. Food. As a child, I learned to become greedy about food. I would take more than I need. My mother would say, your eyes are bigger than your stomach, this kind of thing. And I said, and she was right. So I'm sorry, but it's touching on deep questions here. How do you know what you need? What do you need? What do you have to be to know you don't need to have a pile of French fried potatoes? You just got this much French fried potatoes or that much of a piece of pie is perfectly necessary. Fine. If you eat it, you're fine. But no, you take more, some of us. Now, some of us are not like that. We don't eat enough, or we are. There's another documentary about food that needs to be done. Anyhow, food and money. I forgot about that. Money, sex, time, and food. We did the next one. So, in order to not be greedy, one has to be conscious of what of oneself. And that means to know my desires, to know what the body really needs or what my psyche really needs. And I don't really know that as I am really. I just desire. Now, I can go on because it gets us into the question of desires. The capitalist system that we know thrives on creating desires, not just set. It's one thing to satisfy needs. That's very pure and good. And not just material needs or food and shelter, but man, human beings are much more than animals needing food and shelter. They need, maybe they need art, maybe they need beauty, maybe they need refinement. That's not bad. We can go into that another time. There are needs that are, represent the transcendent parts of ourselves in some way that we need to live not just by eating necessary food, but maybe we need to eat very good food, you know. But then come desires. Now, usually what we need, we desire. Sometimes, though, we get so screwed up that we have many needs, but they don't correspond to what we desire. And that's almost definition of neurosis or even psychosis in a way. So desires, all right, so then money becomes an instrument for satisfying desires that are somehow there. But desires can be artificially created by the external world, by society, by culture, by imitation, and it becomes a real bottomless pit that what the spiritual traditions call the desire nature is bottomless. There's no end to the more you feed it, the more it wants. You can create endless desires, and that's what for a long time, since at least the early part of the 20th century, capitalism, or the American business, transformed human beings into consumers. We began to be called consumers. What a horrible title, you know, consumer. And advertising and business discovered you can create desires. You don't have to satisfy them only, you create them. New desires, new toothpaste, new cars, new this, new that. To make people feel they're going to be happy by satisfying the desires that we have created. And that went in bottomless pit to more and more the creation of desires that bring pleasure up to a point. Maybe it lasts for a minute or maybe a month or half a day, but it always goes away, and you need more and more. And that became what our business system, our production system was rooted in that, and it still is. So this is an ancient teaching that the desire nature, you know, is when that becomes the dominant thing, mental, psychologically, physical desires, then you are really in hell. This is a Buddhist hell. Then at least one of the lower worlds of Buddhism is symbolized by what they call the hungry ghosts, which I wrote about in the book. The hungry ghost is this phantom being with a huge belly and a little thin pinprick mouth and arms and legs that float out, and it's always looking for food, to feed. And the more it eats, the more it wants. The more everything it eats makes it hungrier. Not only that, it burns as it's going down. And that's almost like the definition of our economic system in that respect. Hungry, we've become hungry ghosts. Children have become 30, 20, 50, 100 toys. One toy after another toy. The desires are desires. It's not the parents' fault, it's just the whole culture. So you see, it touches on the most interesting questions, inner questions, how to be aware of our desires and not attached to them so much, and so that we can be free not to be a slave of all these impulses that are conditioned into us. There's another element in us, which is a yearning for truth and for being. That's not just like those desires, but it's a deep human need, and that hasn't been acknowledged in the culture at all. And now it's arising much more in people. Oh boy, Why Can't We Be Good is a book that really I would love to talk about. The American Soul is a book that now you're bringing up, and I'd love to say something about that. America, somebody said, the name of America is to make the world safe for money. American business is a very big thing of America. American economic power. People come here. Immigrants come for freedom, economic freedom, to get ahead. They can't do what they get, they can't move socially, economically in their Europe the way they do here, or in Asia, but here it's, all things are possible in principle. That's one of the great things about America, was that people come here for this kind of freedom. I've talked to so many immigrants, who just particularly from Asia and Middle East, who you can breathe here. And one of them, a man, an Afghan, had a most beautiful statement about America: my mind is free. And we have no idea, we who are born here, what it's like to have an oppression against our mind, a tyranny over the mind, which Jefferson rebelled against, and all that. So we have become a money-driven, but the question is opening now a little more, money-driven as a nation, political strength, military power, a form of government that is really one of the great achievements of the modern world, is American form, the Constitution, the form of government we have, the democracy, the way it's formed, the way it's structured. It's brilliant. The Constitution, I believe, is a great, great achievement. To go into how it was formed would take us too little more, but beyond the pale. But as I come to understand America, when I started writing about it, and actually going to reading, studying men like Washington, or people like Jefferson and Franklin, and great American figures like Frederick Douglass, and the Native American situation, what we did to that, and the Constitution, I realized America is a spiritually defined nation in one sense, not Christian in the church sense, but it's a spiritually defined nation whose aim, whose strength, whose meaning is to make a safe place, protected, for people the people can come together and search for the conscience, to find conscience, that inner source of moral being, which is at the root of every spiritual tradition. And America's meaning is that, just not just for people to come together and be free from church dogmatism and from civil injustices and from monarchical oppression, that's all good, but it's external, it's liberty. But freedom, the freedom of association, that Tocqueville admired so much, the freedom of people to come together for an inner reason to find their own conscience and live by it. That is what America means. And it's losing it. It's losing it because it's being defined all the time by its external sides, really. And that's good. But liberty as tells us what we're free from, but it doesn't tell us what we're free for. And America is free. Freedom means free to search inwardly with other people, have a community like that. To me, that is the meaning of America. And that was my discovery, writing about America, because I had no idea. I knew America was a problem. I had to find that bridge between tradition, spirituality, and the meaning of America. And I was scared to write about it because I hated American history as a child. It was so boring. But I saw that this really is what America... No, other countries can do that, have done that in the past, too. It was that right now, America was the strongest country to protect that. In other words, its military power is only justifiable if it's protecting something important. If it's just military power for the sake of military power, it's not interesting. It's at the end, America's dead. If it's just economic power, just for the sake of being rich, that's going to go too, like Rome did. But if it's there still to preserve that inner possibility, then it's worth fighting for, I think. You know, other countries have those something of those values, but America has this powerful place in the world where it can still stand and protect that. No other big major nation, I think, has that as its main value. Most countries don't have that. We do have an ability still to change our government if we have to, but Obama has given new hope, so we're all hoping that this is going to reemerge. Everybody, most people with any sense, know that that's not happening. 16 boxes of cereal doesn't make me happy to have that possibility. In fact, it drives me nuts. No, it's... See, we have a strong country in that sense of military and economic, although people now, it's obviously a weak economically, but it's still strong. The world still needs America. Who would take up place at this point? But Thomas Paine made a distinction between government and society. Government is strong, military, it has armies, it has police, it can punish, it can do damage, it can do bad, has to do bad things sometimes. No government can exist and be a saint. People expect America to be like a saint. America, a nation is not an individual. A nation is like a big machine that has a function. And people can't expect a nation to be always nice. A nation's going to have to do, and maybe even do crimes sometimes. But a nation is there to protect society, which is a softer, more humanistic thing, where people can relate to each other in a certain way. And society doesn't have armies. But it exists protected by a government which does have armies. So we have to make that distinction. America, as a nation, is there to protect the society, people, the liberty of people, the freedom of people to find what is true. Now, not everybody has to undergo that search, but unless that search for the inner conscience is undertaken by a number of people in this earth, that's going to be the most dangerous, destructive thing. It's hard to say what's normal about money, how to be normal about money. Let me put it that way to start with. Do I know anybody who's normal about money? No, everybody is weird about money. You find that everybody has some quirk about money, mostly. Some of them haven't discovered it, but they do. So I don't know if money is intrinsically abnormal or not, but. So let's start with that caveat. All I can say is the work of studying how I am with money will normalize how I am with money. And consciousness is the great, awareness is the great normalizing force. The force of human attention directed impartially, warmly toward myself and toward others is a great beneficent force that's not been understood till it's now beginning to be understood some places. So I would say the most healthy thing about money would be to really become conscious of it, how it is, how it works in oneself. So I can't give any specific things, but everybody needs money. I know, let's face it. I do things for money. I try not to compromise with my values, but sometimes one has to do things. I can't answer anything more than that.
No. Any last words at all? Just your perspective on, since, what was it, September 2008, with the economic collapse.
Oh, about that? If only I had X, then I'd be okay. That's what everybody feels. Some people did it, and they're okay, quote. There's always, life is full of that. I think everybody is frightened, everybody's confused. We hope there's somebody up there that is a little less confused. I think some bold efforts are being made. Nobody knows whether they're going to succeed. But the most important part of it to me is what I hope is not going to be spent, not going to be dispersed, is the sense of trust somewhere in the leadership. Obama's victory was a great victory for some, in the sense that people were feeling there's now someone I can trust. It's being chipped away, but not necessarily very much. It's still the back, there's a huge bank of trust and hope in this man and what is around him. So I don't say that we should trust something or someone that's not trustworthy, but the crisis will not disappear until trust returns in the country. And people think that things have to get better so that I can then trust them. But the other arrow goes the other way too, maybe even more. It's that when I start trusting them, they will get better. So let's try to trust without being naive, without being foolish. Let's try to trust that the country has really risen to bring somebody into leadership who nobody ever believed would be able to get there. So this hope is still there. That's my last word on the subject, because it echoes the famous lines of the saying, the Islamic, great Islamic saying, which is echoed in the Jewish tradition too, is this, trust in Allah, but tie your camel first. So let's trust, if we can trust, but still make as many smart moves as we can and watch your you-know-what.